Okay, I think we'll get started. And as people drift in, we'll let them know they missed the most important slide today. And there it is. So this section here actually is a bit of a mix. So there'll be a lecture of about maybe half an hour. And then we're going to give you guys an hour or so to work on MetaboAnalyst. So this is kind of a mix of a lecture slash lab. I'll turn back on at some point about 15 minutes before the end of the session, which I guess will be around 3:15, and then we'll cover a couple other items. You have actually both the slides for this lecture, but you also have a couple of tutorials, and in particular there is a tutorial immediately after section or module 7. This module as well with the slides has a series of questions as well as sort of a walkthrough. So you can use the slides or you can use the tutorial, which is published in Nature Protocols, sort of to take you through some of the data. Likewise, you guys earlier this morning prepared a data set, and you can actually use that data set if you want. There's also other data sets that are available through MetaboAnalyst on the website that you can go through. The tutorial that's with your binders and the one that I'm using as part of an example is an example data set that's right on the website. So what we're trying to do here is to get you familiar with sort of the standard workflow for metabolomic data analysis. It's generic. Many of the same techniques and technologies produce similar kinds of data sets with similar kinds of issues. But obviously, every experiment's a little different. We'll try and go through things like data integrity detection or checking, outlier detection, quality control, normalization, and scaling, and transformation. And we'll use this with an online tool called MetaboAnalyst, which is something that Jeff wrote when he was just a young student. So as I said, and we've seen this slide, and we'll see a few other slides, but typically, whether it's metabolomics or any other omics experiment, we will have control and cases, or treatment A, treatment B, and we'll have populations where we're collecting samples or measuring things. And those will largely be called sort of biological replicates. They're not perfectly replicated, but they are the samples that allow us to get good statistics. In many cases, we'll also do technical replicates, and this is an important part of almost any study, and we talked about that yesterday, and I'll mention it a bit again today. But in many cases, people will, especially with LC-MS, will do multiple runs of the same sample. Sometimes they'll put in quality checks, which are a little different than technical replicates. But the technical replicates are a way of measuring the performance of your instrument. Whereas the biological replicates are really ways of measuring the variation of your biological system. And we know there's a fair bit of variability in human and even rat and mouse biological systems, a fair bit of variation in plant and microbial systems. And that's important because that gives you your population statistics. Technical replicates are really intended to help you address area issues of systematic error, as well as issues related to noise and false positives and things like that typically arise in particularly MS-type experiments. We're looking here at the two routes to metabolomics. Again, the protocol or workflow diverges a little bit depending on whether you're doing sort of chemometric or untargeted versus a targeted method. But there is also a fair bit of convergence at some point. And what we're giving or going to give you this time, at least with the example I'll be using these slides, is an example of quantitative or targeted metabolomics. The data that you would have had for your XCMS work would be one that you would use for untargeted or a chemometric method. So the workflow with the chemometric or untargeted methods is a data integrity check. You guys have done the spectral or chromatographic alignment and binning. There's aspects of data normalization that's important. Quality control, that's QC, outlier removal. Then there's the data reduction analysis. And then once you've winnowed everything down to perhaps a few dozen peaks or features, then you get into the compound identification. In the targeted methods, you start off with the data integrity check just to make sure things are okay, but then you start straight away into compound identification quantification. Then, with that data list, you would go to normalization, quality control, outlier removal, and then you follow on with the data reduction and the data analysis. So, slightly different sequence, but very similar steps that are done. In the case of the XCMS data, you'd typically be probably starting about here. In the data sets that I will be giving you, you'll also be starting about here. So in terms of data integrity, we've talked about this a lot, particularly with MS, there's lots and lots of false positives. And we talked about how to eliminate those in, I think it was module 3. So there's the adducts and derivatization products that we see with GC, there's isotopomers, breakdown or neutral loss issues, some ionization, multiple charge species. So say this is not a problem with NMR, but obviously NMR is not as sensitive, and so it's sort of a compromise. These are some tools and links that help identify or help deal with some of the adduct. I gave you other links before, but these would be sort of examples of perhaps noise or shifts or issues of data integrity and quality. We've just spent a good chunk of time going through spectral alignment, and that's what we saw XCMS is used for, particularly with GC and LCMS. In NMR, there are tools, particularly offered, I think, through Bruker, for doing spectral alignment for NMR, although it's not that important. Again, things don't vary that much, except in cases of pH. So some use warping algorithms, others use essentially time shift algorithms or peak shifting algorithms. And we've seen, again, some examples that do that sort of spectral alignment. So again, typically with LC GCMS data, if you are doing non-targeted work, there's quite a bit of advanced prep work, cleaning, aligning, peak removal. It's quite onerous. And because there's so many features, typically people try and reduce those features very early on. The targeted approach or quantitative metabolomics, things are typically opposite to that. You're already focused on the compound identification. You don't generally have to worry about issues of alignment. You don't have to worry about issues of noise and other things. You can do things like binning. This can be done with mass spec, GCMS. It's more frequently done with NMR. This is a trick to deal with peaks in a fairly consistent way. Now, these days, computers are so fast that binning is slowly disappearing and people are just simply measuring the data points. But you'll look at the literature and there are plenty of examples even today where people use binning processes. It's just the bins get really, really tiny, almost to the point where they're just handling individual data points. So binning is a way of sort of reducing the amount of data, but disk space is cheap these days, and so we don't tend to worry about that much. Normalizing and scaling. Sometimes you deal with dilutions. Best example probably is urine. But there are many other cases where if you're doing cell extracts or lipid extracts or other types of tissue extracts, the protocols will have differing areas of values of recovery. To scale things so that you're able to match. And in fact, the two spectra here are of the same sample, but just diluted by a factor of about 3 or 4. So you can try and scale, or again, I'll use the word normalize with the alternate meaning, to match things, again, to sort of correct for that systematic dilution difference or whatever that may be leading to that systematic change. So things like normalizing to the integrated area of all organic peaks. It's often done with urine. There's a probabilistic quotient method. People also use internal standards. That's primarily used in NMR, and it's probably often the preferred method overall. And we can also normalize or scale according to sample-specific weights or volumes. Each of these depends on the conventions of the group, people that typically analyze these things. There's sort of a consensus that many groups work on, and depending on whether they're plant biologists or clinicians or people that study urine or people that study tissue or people that study microbes. Another approach to scaling is to scale to features. And here's a spectrum where we just see one giant feature. Here. And that can help in some cases manage or deal with certain types of analyze outliers. But you can also, when I go back to scaling, then we also get back into normalization. We can scale for concentrations to help give things a normal distribution. And this gets back to this log transformation to give normal distributions. There's also things like autoscaling and Pareto scaling, which also can help with giving you a better normal distribution and range scaling. So these things, some are to deal with, as I say, systematic errors. Others are to deal with essentially making things look more normally distributed so that t-tests and ANOVA tests and other things can be applied. This filtering, removing things like case of NMR solvent peaks, case of MS noise, false positives that are coming out from blanks. Typically you need some level of justification. You can't randomly, arbitrarily remove peaks. So that's a filtering step, and we've talked about that particularly for GC and LC-MS. The issue of outlier removal, another one that we've sort of talked a little bit about. And then in terms of data reduction, formally you can think of that as trying to reduce data so that it's more understandable, but you can also think of it as dimensional reduction, which we do in PCA, so hundreds of dimensions down to a few. So that's also data reduction. And it allows us to sort of handle things more consistently. Clustering is another approach to help with data reduction, data analysis. So all of these things are steps, are components, all part of the workflow. And they sort of change with depending on whether you're doing targeted or untargeted metabolomics. So to help with the workflow, and because those steps often involve combinations of statistics, large tables, and combined with the fact that you can't do it all in Excel, we developed MetaboAnalyst, and so it's now in version 2.0. So Jeff got the idea some years ago, seeing how much most of us struggled. He also got himself very familiar with R and with web-based design. MetaboAnalyst is actually used by thousands of people now. We've had to scale up the servers multiple times just to deal with the workload. Today we may yet break it if we've got 22 people hitting it at the same time. We'll see. Jeff is sweating there in the back. But it is designed not just for one type of platform. It's for LC-MS, it's for GC-MS, it's also for NMR-based metabolomic. It's supports both workflows, untargeted and targeted. It supports both types of data analysis, univariate and multivariate. So you can do t-tests, ANOVA, and PCA and PLSTA. It doesn't do, I think, the Mann-Whitney U-test. So we'll see if we can convince Jeff to add that to MetaboAnalyst. But what it does do is it identifies significantly altered metabolites. It produces a lot of colorful plots that you guys saw today earlier with XCMS. And Jeff spent a good deal of time trying to develop very detailed explanations and summaries. The idea was just upload your data, press a button, and then your paper is written for you. It's not quite that way, but it's getting close. It also links things to pathways. And so this is as we go from lists to pathways, and this is this connection, and then from pathways to biology and to understanding things. And so this is what MetaboAnalyst is intended to do. So there's a workflow, and it guides you through that. And if you, Jeff?
How do you access from using the Firefox from use Chrome? There's also one on the website. Is Chrome too slow?
Okay, everyone heard that? So don't use Chrome for accessing MetaboAnalyst. It's the phase of the moon. So right now, three or four steps. You start with the data pre-processing step. Then you do what we'll call generically normalization. So that includes both scaling and converting the data so that it looks normally distributed. Then there's the data analysis, which is the PCA stuff that we talked about, PLSTA. And then the annotation, which gets into aspects of maybe identifying metabolites if you're doing untargeted, but also allowing you to do pathway analysis and other things that are probably more biologically interesting. This is a very detailed description of what's done, the flow through, and the types of support that MetaboAnalyst does. I'm not going to go through it in detail. You guys have this slide. But it just really emphasizes the breadth that's there. And this probably, I don't know if this covers Analyst 2.0 or if it's still from 1.0, but there's a lot. A lot in the system and a lot that's supported. You'll see that there's metabolite set enrichment. If you've ever heard of microarray enrichment, this is picked up from that. It's actually on its own become quite popular in metabolomics. Time series analysis, which again is quite unique to MetaboAnalyst. It has its image center, so people are actually using a lot of the plots for high resolution images for papers and things like that. It has all the tools for the data processing and data normalization and integrity checking. There's the functional interpretation, which is pathway analysis and enrichment, the statistical work that most of you guys are interested in. And there's a whole bunch of other utilities for peak identification, conversion, name conversion, lipid analysis, batch effect, temporal drift studies, method comparisons, and so on. So we're going to go through sort of four steps here, although I'll only take you, I think, to the first one or two, and then we'll leave it to you guys to sort of follow along using either the slides, your computers, or the tutorial, which is at the back of this section, which is actually quite detailed and quite popular with people. So if you go to MetaboAnalyst, and I think that we can, somewhere on the website, you can just type in the name MetaboAnalyst on Google and it'll take you there. What you'll find is that there's a menu. So you can click through here. There's lots of tutorials, resources, information about data formats, and overview. To start the program, and this is probably the most challenging part to MetaboAnalyst, is that there's this relatively small region, which is you have to click here to start. Most people on the website sort of expect that it's already started, but you actually have to start up MetaboAnalyst by clicking at the top. If you were to look at some of the data sets, there are, by clicking on the data formats, there are a bunch of data sets that you can download or zipped files. Some are NMR, some are mass spec, some are bin, some are process, time series. There's a whole bunch of data sets that you can access. You can download them, keep them on the computer, but you can also access a couple data sets right online that are example data sets. It talks about what CSV files are. You guys probably get familiar. Those are the Excel file formats that we were saving things in this morning. So let's start in, as I say, to look at sort of the initial steps of data processing. So first thing you want to do is convert your raw data into some kind of data matrix, which is, again, something you did this morning, where you have samples and then peaks or samples and concentrations of metabolites. It's something that's associated with a value. So those could be concentration tables, which is my own preference in metabolomics. As I say, I think I'm trying to sort of impress upon you that quantitative or targeted metabolomics generally gives you the richest data. But the untargeted set, which you generated today, you'll get your peak lists. You can also do spectral bins, and you can also do sort of the raw spectra, which need a little bit of processing, obviously. So once you've started, pressed start, you end up with this sort of view here. And you can choose to upload your data. And I think if we scroll down, I believe there'd be other example data sets you could just upload. But if you've already downloaded or you've already saved your data from this XCMS experiment or this work we did this morning, or if you wanted to use the NMR data or whatever else is here, you have to tell what type it is. Is it a concentration table, spectral bins, or is it peak intensity? Some also the format. Are there rows, samples in rows, or samples in columns? People switch them, and you can't tell unless someone tells you. And then you can select the file from your computer, it uploads, and you can then submit. So you can submit Excel files, or you can submit zip files, which is a fairly common way of doing this. Now what you'll see here is that this is sort of a control panel. This takes you through the workflow. Load your data, process your data, do your statistics on your data, and then try and interpret things. So it could be if this was untargeted work, this would help you a lot of, at some point, start to figure out after you've found what were the interesting peaks to figure out what they are. This is more if you've already figured out what those peaks are and know what those compounds are, you can start doing things like pathway analysis and metabolite set enrichment analysis and other things that are biologically interesting. So as I said, you could have uploaded files that you've already saved. Or, as you say, if you scroll down a little further, you'll find these sets of files. These are all have all been tested, processed. You can see what came out of them. You can link to the publications so you can understand a little bit more about them. And so these are all the types of formats and types of files that metabolomics can handle. So LC, GC, NMR, and so on. So here's something that I don't think anyone here is doing a lot of agricultural research, so this is a little bit out, but here we're looking at a set of dairy cattle, and we're feeding them grain. Most cows don't like grain, but we do this actually to help increase milk production, but they know there's an issue with it. A lot of cows get very sick when you increase the amount of grain that they eat, so it's a bit of interest. And basically, grain causes stomach upset in cows, really serious. And so the idea here was we're looking at rumen, ruminal fluid. Cows have multi-chambered stomachs, and they're sort of walking fermenters. So we looked at this using quantitative NMR metabolomics. So that's the data set that I'll sort of step you through, and this is one you could use if you just wanted to walk through. So the first thing we do is upload that data. So it's a set of concentration tables. Metabolites have been identified. We're looking at different states. There's four populations. If you want, 0, 15, 30, and 45. And what's done here is after we've uploaded the data, there is this essentially a data check. It's looking at how many samples. There are four groups. They found that the samples were not paired. There are 47 variables. Everything's numeric. So it's just reporting back, saying if things are... There are some, about 3% of the data entries had zero values. Sometimes this can be problems for metabolomics. And then there can also be missing values. So someone made an entry mistake or they didn't put something in. So typically for missing values and zero values, what is done, just so the statistics don't mess up, is you replace those with a very small value. And that value is usually chosen amongst the lowest values divided by, I don't know, a factor of 5 or 10. Is it 5? So it still allows you to work with normally distributed data, but it's safe to assume that these values are below the limit of detection. You can impute values. That's infer or calculate values if you want to do a little bit better in terms of how you handle the missing values. Or you can just say, we'll take those low values and carry on, and usually that's fine. The next step is normalization or scaling. And as I say, normalization means many things, and it's unfortunate that we use the term. But we can normalize the rows, and in this case, the rows are the samples, rows are samples in this case, and the columns are the metabolites. So. We can choose not to do any normalization, and part of that is maybe looking a little bit at your data. We can normalize by some median or reference sample. We can normalize by a reference feature, or we can do some sample-specific normalization. So there's lots of choices. In this particular case, we chose a pooled average from the sample group, and that's usually a safe one. And then the next one is trying, how do we normalize the metabolite concentrations? And in many cases, particularly with LC-MS, metabolite concentrations are quite distorted. They can also be somewhat distorted or skewed in NMR. And so you can either generally log or auto-scaling works well. In this case, we chose auto-scaling partly because we found auto-scaling worked better than log and worked better than Pareto scaling. But these are options. And these are things, the intent is here to not just say, oh, I'll click this and I won't think about it. What you're going to see is a result shortly, and you want to be able to assess that result and whether that's worthwhile. So, say the data as it's coming in, we've got these samples and rows, and the compounds or peaks or bins are in the columns. And these are the different normalization routines for row-wise and column-wise. And then idea with the row-wise, that is dealing with the samples, is to sort of make these things comparable. So if there were dilution effects, if it was rumen, this would help scale things. So it's more formally, I guess I would call it scaling rather than normalization. Column normalization is to try and make things in this normal distribution. Need the normal distributions to do standard statistics. And there's several methods that MetaboAnalyst offers. So in this case, we've chosen auto-scaling. And this is the thing you want to see. So here is what your distribution, these are your metabolites. There's about 40 here. And most of them are pretty small. They're in tens of micromolars. But then there's a few of them, acetate and butyrate, which are really, really high. So the net effect is that in terms of a distribution for concentration, this is a classic exponential or extreme value distribution. This is not useful for statistics. If you just use this without transforming or normalizing, you would get awful results. So what you do is, in this case, we've used the auto-scaling function. This is to normalize. And it converts this really bad skewed value into what almost looks like a perfect bell curve. And you can see that acetate has been nicely normalized and butyrate has been nicely normalized. And so we now have a distribution which is normal. Now we could have gone back and said, oh, we tried auto scaling, it didn't work. Now let's try Pareto and this now maybe looks better. Or we could try log scaling. And so the idea is it can be interactive. And you can't know in advance, really. So this is why this function is particularly important. And it's particularly key in any kind of data analysis to make sure that your data is normally distributed. So we've now got the metabolites normally distributed. Same thing could have been done with genes and proteins. It's the same thing that's required. So now we can also deal with some quality control. Scaled things, and so we can do usually by visual inspection. You can't really write a routine for this, but trying to look for peaks or concentrations or entries that are just out there. And these may be typographical errors. If you think you can prove they are, you can remove them or fix them. In other cases, the quality control can also help with the noise reduction, trying to get rid of some of the spectral bins. So this is a qualitative thing, and that's what quality control is about. You can't really define exactly the way to do it. You just have to do it by eye, and I think you just have to try and do it honestly, where you're not just trying to selectively pick the best data. So here's what an example of an outlier looks like. You can see an outlier sometime in your scores plot. There's something that's way out there. You can see an outlier in a heat map plot. And as I say, this either indicates a typographical error or something very bizarre that you probably want to sort out. And if you can't figure it out, it's just going to cause you no end of trouble. So in this case, you can remove the value and justify it to yourself or to your supervisor of why it should be taken out. You can remove things, so you can actually go into the data editor in MetaboAnalyst and look at your data tables, and you can decide if this particular outlier is worth removing to get rid of it. Yeah, well, unfortunately, I think that's basically the way it is. I don't think there is a formal algorithm that we can use. I mean, I think every data set is different, and some of it will be quite different depending on the circumstances of how the samples are collected, the instruments that are used, how the data sets have been merged, and so. I think there are probably more formal approaches that it could systematically calculate each of the normalization steps and then calculate a fit to a normal curve and come out with some quality thing. But the reason why we tend to do this interactively is because it would take too long as a web server, and so it's sort of a compromise. And in fact, there are issues that you'll see here where to make it a functional web server, we have had to sort of compromise on a couple of things.
Yeah. The other one is we are doing multiple compounds, multivariate. There's no such things you can read it. This is multivariate. We just cannot define it. So basically, just visual, try to do individual and make it individual, and each one seems normal. You think probably combining is still normal.
So we were looking at the quality check, outlier remover, then there's this noise reduction. Sometimes this is a case of dealing with very small values, others that just seem to be constant values. Again, this can happen in some cases. So I think right now we still have this limit of 5,000 points coming in. I don't know if that's still necessary. But this is, again, trying to get rid of really arguably low-value noise, which will have low value in the analysis, but which unfortunately increases a lot of the computation time. So if we had everything local, it's something we may not worry as much about, but because it's a server, it is something we have to worry about. Now, a number of groups around the world have actually downloaded MetaboAnalyst and run it as a local system for their whole laboratory. In fact, many of the larger national centers, I think, in the Netherlands and Australia, I'm not sure if people in the States are using it yet, but having a local version makes things obviously a lot faster. So there are ways of selecting and removing noise, things that have very low variance, things that are very, very low in intensity, and there are ways that you can select to do that noise reduction. Again, it's sort of interactive, it's up to you. In the case of NMR data or quantitative data, you don't have to worry about this. In the case of untargeted, it is an issue typically. The data reduction is, okay, now you've cleaned up your data, you've filtered the noise, you've normalized it and scaled it, you've spruced it up, you've packaged it, so it's ready to go into things like PCA, PLSDA, and all subsequent analyses. So this is where we're going to sort of launch you guys on your own. We've taken you through some of these slides about here's the data set you can analyze, here's how you should be able to probably tweak it, how you could fix it, in this case the data from the cattle. But the next step is you know, let's find those important compounds. Let's see if we can interpret them in a biological way. And most of you are not experts in cattle metabolism, so maybe this will give you some insights to it. We're going to look at different phenotypes. We're kind of trying to look at different ways of classifying. You guys could, instead of using the cattle data, you could start using the XCMS data, which was on the, we think it was a knockout study on fatty acid hydrolase. We don't know what the biology is on that one, but so I think some normals and some knockouts. Find out what was unusual about that one. But what I'd like you to do, and some of you came in after I started, is to use the slides to take you through the rest of MetaboAnalyst. So turn on MetaboAnalyst, go to the web, and use the slides, and there are a series of questions that are asked. The slides give you different options about what you can try, give you some example output, which you should be able to repeat, gives you some views that you should be able to try, and then here are some questions specifically for the cattle data to try and answer. And you can try and write those answers in your book. You can work together. You can work alone. We're not prohibiting you from doing anything on that regard. You can try the hierarchical mapping. You can generate different images. Again, some more questions. Looking at patterns of change and trends, correlations, more questions. Here are some PCA plots that you should and could be able to generate. Look at your loading plots. Again, we can see some of those things are up in the upper corners or lower corners are the ones that are most responsible for that, those kinds of separation. You can go from 2D to 3D. Some more questions to answer. You can plot scores. There's lots of evaluations of Q-stars. You can look at the variable importance plot, or VIP plot, identifying the most important metabolites, their weightings, what they're contributing. This is a particularly useful plot, and frequently shows up in many metabolomic studies. You can test the performance and the quality of your PLSDA plot. This is quite an exceptional separation in terms of significance through permutation tests. And you can look at and answer some more questions. So I'm just skipping through this, but these are things that you can do with the data, with sample data, You can choose not to do it and just work with some data that you have on your own. So you have the next, hour to plug away on this. So we could either download a file. This is the cow data. There's another human data set. So you could just click under there. So this is under data formats. So that's one way. So you can put the data locally on your computer. Alternately, you can just start a package. And it's in the upload section, and you can scroll down, you can say, try our test data. And you can choose, here's the Rumen one. You can click on that one. And submit. So, different ways of getting the data or using the data. You don't have to use the cow data. You could use the cancer data. You could use the...
use the data that we generate SMR.
Yeah.
Yeah, actually, one of the generated data SMR on that, we say that MS is the same. They're going
from the data.
Yeah. Fourth one from Bolivia. Yeah, that's the one. You can use that one, or you upload your own, but that's the same.
So, as I say, you're on your own at this stage. Do what you'd like. If you have a preference, if there's, whether it's physiology, biology, or platform that you prefer. We'll take you there. So we're going to give you another, 25 minutes or whatever. I'm kind of losing track of time. We're going from 1:30 to 3. Is that right? Okay, so we're going to give you until about 2:45, and then we'll get into the pathway stuff. So what you guys should try and do is see if you can step along till about slide 82 in module 7. And then at that stage, you can say you're ready for the next phase.
Yeah, at this time, don't try the broad spectrum because you're going to be so actually easy. Just try the other.
Now again, you can work with the slides, but there's, as I said, a very detailed Nature Protocols tutorial, which is somewhat similar to this, with a lot more detail, just at the back of Module 7. So, get to here.
Is this slide?
That's your last slide.
Page
41. Yeah, you'll be, if you go through the tutorial or the next 40 slides, it'll tell you, say, upload this, try this. So just sort of follow that slide set along.
The quality control using simulated data, so it's the data where you connect don't have the outlier. So that you start from the ANOVA follow up, just from the slide they showed up, this is your task, just starting from there. Quality control, that bad action, the bad data is not the data that you use. command app analyst in your real world, use a hardwired to connect near the cable. Don't use wireless. Cable wireless just unstable. Once you change the IP, the connection is lost. Start working on, when off and on, your IP just like between, right? I think that's your screen will be sometimes shut off to save the power. In that case, sometimes the connection, the wireless connection also gone. And when you reconnect, you lost your session. So just keep your mouse moving every once in a while.
So how are people progressing? Are you getting towards page 38, 39, 40, and 41? Are people still on page 20? Again, feel free to work together. You don't have to do everything independently.
Oh, okay. about adding some U test, within U test, right?
Yes.
I added there.
It's in there now?
Yeah, it's at all the non-parametric there.
Okay, I think what we're going to do, it's now 2:45, and we're just going to go into this about 5 or 10 minutes of the metabolic pathway analysis, which is part of MetaboAnalyst 2. They'll still give you 5 or 10 minutes at the end of this session, but you can also work through coffee if you want to look at some of these other things or to finish out what we were doing on MetaboAnalyst. Michelle. Okay, so if you flip to page 42, so if you raced along, you would have started, you would have gone through some of the aspects where we were looking at these cattle, dairy cattle data. You also might have looked a little bit at the metabolite set enrichment analysis, or MSEA. And then we're just going to go straight into the metabolic pathway analysis, or MET-PA. MET-PA actually was written as an independent module and published separately some years ago, but it's now been integrated in MetaboAnalyst 2. As I said, we've gone from, you know, spectra, from spectra to peaks, and peaks to compound lists, and compound lists to some data analysis, and now have to go to pathways. So MET-PA was originally written to help enhance MSEA, and was designed, yes, Michelle? It's actually still going, I think.
That's great.
So there's going to be a long blank here, but anyways, it's got, it allows you to look at pathway structures and also allows you to support pathway visualization. It works on 15 model organisms, including humans, but fruit flies, Arabidopsis, I think, and a few others. A lot of that is based on data that is in KEG. So you guys are familiar with this page, and what you guys originally were clicking on was statistical analysis. And if you clicked on enrichment analysis, that's MSEA. And now if you go to pathway analysis, this is what you'll see. And in this example, or what we'd like you to do after my little spiel here, is to click on the use example data. In this case, it's data from a set of cancer patients who had what's called cachexia. So this is a muscle wasting phenomenon that happens in about half of all cancer patients. And the idea is, are there ways of actually identifying or predicting individuals who actually will develop cachexia? Because this is an important prognostic indicator. The individuals had lung and colon cancer, and as I said, about half were going to experience muscle wasting. At the time the samples were taken, we didn't know whether they were going to develop cachexia or not. So this is essentially trying to look at what are the processes leading to it, what are the processes that might allow you to predict it. So just like we did before, we do normalization. In this case, the row-wise normalization is not necessary, but there is auto-scaling to try and get normalized data. And then we jump down from the statistics or data uploads to sort of setting the parameters and the pathways. And so in this case, we're trying to choose which pathway. These are humans. So no point choosing chickens or zebrafish. So clicking on humans, it's now doing what's called network topology analysis. So we have a reference metabolome, and we're looking at pathway enrichment analysis and pathway topology analysis, and there's several choices. These are explained a little bit actually in the paper on MetPA. I won't go into a lot. You can ask Jeff as well on some of the specifics. But this is relevant not only for metabolism, but it's also in protein networks. And a lot of the theory and concepts were developed for this. They're also emerged through web and internet traffic analysis and other things. There are hubs and there are bottlenecks. So hubs often are considered to be the most important proteins, genes, or metabolites. They're highly connected, just like hubs and spokes in a wheel. So the pink ones are actually hubs. Then there are things that lead into potentially other areas, and those are called bottlenecks. And the blue node here is identified as a bottleneck. And in the field of graph theory, there are measures of these types of hubness and bottlenecks, and so this is called degree centrality and betweenness centrality. So a hub has a high degree of centrality, and a bottleneck has a high degree of betweenness centrality. So one of the things that you can do is plot out these pathways, and this uses a very simplified view of the pathways drawn out. So this is KEG, and these are KEG identifiers. And in this case, what we're seeing is the pathway for glycine-serine metabolism. In this case, what we're seeing here is a plot of the importance or impact of the pathway. And then there's sort of a negative log p, so the equivalent of a p-value, you know, minus point, or 0.01, 0.05, 0.005. So the more, the higher the value, greater the negative log. So this node up here, which is at an extreme end here, seems to be the most important one with respect to cachexia. Clicking on that node, which right now just shows up as a point, pops up this visualization of glycine serine threonine. So it suggests, as I say, that based on its position, pathway impact, log p, that this is the most important pathway. Clicking on any one of these ones, which are sort of up here, and you'd have to do this yourself, will identify other pathways of interest. Yes?
So the pathway impact is related to the centralness that you just talked, like where it belongs, or?
Jeff can probably give you, yeah, it's a measure of both the centrality and the... What you're also seeing is that there's, of the pathways or the metabolites that were significantly perturbed, many of them are in this one. So you've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 that are significant. There's a coloring scheme, which also indicates how important they are. And given that, you know, NMR is only doing a light sampling of metabolism, the fact that you're getting so many is quite unusual, and that's why it's getting this sort of off-the-chart impact as well as an off-the-chart p-value. So that's telling you or associating you with certain aspects of catabolism or anabolism. But I think it's also important to remember, and I brought this up before, that pathways we're seeing are just those, the catabolic and anabolic pathways. And many, particularly branched chain amino acids, a lot of charged amino acids, have vital roles in signaling, in signal transduction, in hormonal regulation, homeostasis, osmolite sensing. There's many pathways that are not in KEG, and many processes that are not captured. So this is a, you know, first pass, gives you some good indication, and perhaps there is, since cachexia is a catabolic process, this obviously suggests there's something going wrong in this pathway. We can zoom in through the nodes that are isolated here on the control panels. You can click on things and you can actually see the distribution box plots of, in this case, serine that is elevated in cachexic patients but diminished in control patients. So each of the nodes or compound IDs are highlighted. Obviously, it'd be nice to, and I don't know if there's ways of converting the KEG view to actually compound names rather than KEG compounds. But again, since Jeff is here, if you've got any requests, fire them to him. He'll be happy to change things. And then here's a quick question. But these are results that you can see further on by clicking appropriate or sliding down. And gives you some of the actual numeric values. So the one that was furthest up in the corner was glycine serine, but then we can see branched chain amino acid. There's sulfur methane metabolism. Then there's valine branched chain amino acid again. So these two show up twice. We also see arginine and proline being involved. You can go down the list at some point. Some of these things are perhaps only mildly significant. Jeff has produced a number of statistics that you can look at with respect to false discovery rates, measure of impact. There are pathway diagrams that are much more detailed, that are hyperlinked both to KEG, but also to the small molecule pathway database that I talked to you about before. One thing that we probably need to do particularly, and I don't know if Rupa mailed you about this, but sort of it's a little bit of cleanup we have to do with respect to some of the KEG pathways. In principle, there shouldn't be a, at least for humans, there shouldn't be a KEG pathway where there isn't a SNP-DB pathway. So I'd like you guys to try that. You still have about 5 or 10 minutes left, and you can play around with that. But Metaboanalyst has a lot of things, and in fact, Jeff just informed me that it does have the Mann-Whitney U-test. He's put that into a non-parametric part of Metaboanalyst too. He has random forest, he has support vector machines, has self-organizing maps. He's got time series data, which actually is quite useful, and we haven't seen anything really that does that at all, except in Metaboanalyst. Tools for peak identification, for those of you who are actually looking at that data that we did this morning, may be able to get to starting to identify some of those compounds putatively. There are tools in Metaboanalyst for doing that. I've said before, it's quite popular. The fact that you have the developer right here is someone who's very responsive to requests and suggestions. And it's through workshops like these that we've been able to make improvements steadily over the years. Certainly at this last week's Metabolomic Society conference, lots of people were using it and posting things from the website on their posters and presentations. This is just some quick shots of the time series analysis and some cool clustering options you can do. Some of the quality checking that allows you to look at batch-to-batch variations, which is sometimes quite important. This is an example where things are going nicely, and then something went terribly wrong. Often people don't look at that closely enough, and this is a source of systematic error. It's actually more important than you think. If I had more time, I could spend a whole afternoon about the issue of quality checking. Most labs don't spend near enough time.